the light. Before the world revolved around the sun, God on high stepped down into time and wrote the story of his love for everyone. He has filled our hearts with wonder, so that we always tonight, open up our eyes to see the majesty and glory of the King. He has filled our hearts with wonder, so that we always remember you and I are made to worship. You and I are forgiven and free. Yeah, when you and I grace surrender, you and I choose to be. You and I will see what we were meant to be. Even the rocks cry out, even the heavens shout at the sound of his holy name. Good morning, church. How are you?
Morning.
Good morning to you. Won't you please stand? We're going to start today off just by thanking God for the next breath that we all take and for the wonderful looking crowd that we have here, and that technology gets us to you at home, and that He is God and we are not. And that sounds too cliche, but at the end of this service, when you hear this message, God is going to answer Job, and it's not what he expects. So we, here and now during our worship time, are going to remember just who God is. Amen? All right. Let's get the scripture up. Comes from the book of Revelation, and it's cool, it's coming, but so is Christmas. Revelation 4, 8 and 11. We're going to say it all together, okay? And don't be worried about all of us being together. Let's just say it together. Here we go.
Holy, holy, holy is the Lord God Almighty, who was and is and is to come. You are worthy, our Lord and God, to receive glory and honor and power, for you created all things, and by your will they were created and have their being.
Does that put God in the right place that he needs to be today? This morning? Yes? Okay. All right. We are to continue living through what we're going through. All right? We need to keep on living. That means we need to thrive. That's what we're going to do. By the water, we never will run dry. So living water flowing through, God, we ask for more of you. Fill our hearts and flood our souls with one desire, just to know. Digging deep to know our Father's heart. Into the world we're reaching out to show them who you are. We're going to sing our way into our prayer time. This is a beautiful anthem. Stands with some of the best anthems out there, and praising the name of Jesus and Godhead, three in one, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Seated if you would.
As we were singing that song, I was thinking of the scripture that tells us that because he suffered, he's able to uphold us and strengthen us when we go through our times. And when we go through trouble, when we go through difficult times, when we go through suffering, we know that Jesus hung on the cross in our place to take our sins. And in all that he suffered, he identifies with us and he's able to strengthen us and uphold us. And those of you who received the weekly email that I sent out, you may have read yesterday some of what I shared about the young man who took his own life just up the road here at Bluff and Southport Roads. I'm 19 years old. I had been at Perry High School last year, I believe. Both of his parents, meth addicts, and from what I was told, they are hardly even aware of really reconciled or come to grips with what's happened to their son, and the aunt that he lived with is taking care of all of that. And I just thought of the tragedy of that. He was so broken, and even though there were those who tried to help him, he came to a point where he couldn't take it anymore. And I shared with you the story about the little fourth grade girl that's in our daughter Christy's school. And Christy is a social worker there. And this fourth grader, her mom overdosed on drugs and died in January. And her father OD'd and died in July. And she's been living with a grandmother. And now the grandmother is in the hospital awaiting surgery within the next week. And you have this little girl that, who knows what's going to happen to her. And the thing that breaks my heart is that those kind of stories I think can be multiplied hundreds, if not thousands of times in our community, in our city, in our state, in our country, around the world. There's so much brokenness, so much agony, so much suffering. And I think this morning in our prayer time, and as in addition to lifting whatever burdens you have on your heart, we need to pray for those who are suffering, and especially those who are suffering without any hope, that they don't know Christ, they don't know the presence of his Spirit, and they're facing all of these things, continued unemployment, loss of income, their kids are struggling, families are struggling, even though some kids are back in school. I mean, this whole thing is just, it's a heavy, heavy thing that people are going through right now. And we may feel like we're on the blessed side of things and God is helping us through things, but man, there are people just right down the street who are hurting and suffering. And we as God's people, as his church, need to lift our voices in prayer for those who are suffering, and pray most of all that they'll be drawn to God's embrace, they'll be drawn to Jesus, and they'll come to find the peace that they need and the comfort and the hope. So we're going to take a few minutes for you to pray together or individually, but we're joining our hearts together. Just take a few moments of silent prayer, and then I'll close our prayer time in a minute. Lord, we confess that we are a broken people. There is suffering and there is pain around us, and there are people who are wrestling with really hard things, and a lot of us and a lot of them are maybe wrestling with hard questions, and we may be tempted to wonder where you are in the midst of all of this. And we pray, Jesus, that you would come. We pray that you would return and that you would set all things right. But until that day, we pray that you would come through your people, through your church, that your Spirit would come, and that those who are struggling and those who are hurting and those who are in despair and those who are lost, we pray that they would be drawn to you. Use your people, your church, across this land, around this world, to point people to you, the way, the truth, the life. May we find our hope in you. We pray for those families right now who are struggling, who don't have money to pay the bills, who maybe have gotten an eviction notice. We pray for those families where there are people who are struggling with addiction, where there is violence in the home. We pray for the children of our nation. We pray that you would be their comforter, that you would be their savior. We pray that you'll help us to find ways as we look around us and as we're aware of things, to find ways that we can reach out to others who need your touch, who need your grace, who need your mercy. Thank you that you are the God of all comfort and that you comfort us in our trials. And because of that, we can comfort others. So make us people who are compassionate and caring for the needs of those around us. And we pray through all of this that many people's hearts would be turned to you, that people would find their peace and their hope, their salvation in you. Help us to anchor ourselves in that truth and that reality. No matter what happens, you are God. We belong to you. We are part of your family. And your Spirit is at work in our lives, no matter what's happening in the world around us. Thank you for hearing our prayers this morning that we lift to you in Jesus' name. Amen.
We're going to sing My Redeemer Lives, and we're going to talk about standing with him. So those who want to stand with us, please do so.
For I know my Redeemer lives, and in the end he will stand on the earth. For I know my Redeemer lives, and in the end he will reign on the earth. Though my flesh it be strong, yet with my eyes I will see God, for I know that my Redeemer lives, and I will stand with him on that day. For stand with him on that day. Oh, my heart, it yearns within me for the day when Jesus returns. Oh, my heart, it yearns within me. Yeah.
I don't know if you recognized it in that song, but most of the words of that were what Job said in Job chapter 19, and when he affirmed his faith. Over the past few weeks, we've been kind of looking at this conversation that Job had with his three friends. And Job suffered perhaps more than anyone in all of history. You remember he lost all of his possessions, he lost his wealth, he lost his family, his whole family except for his wife, and then he lost his health and began to suffer greatly. And his three friends and him, you know, went on this long back and forth, you know, dialogue. They were trying to convince him that God was punishing him for something terrible that he'd done, and Job was proclaiming his faithfulness, his steadfastness to God. And last week we came to, in Job chapter 31, Job's kind of final defense of his integrity and his righteousness. And before we get in today, what we're going to see is how God answers Job. You don't have to raise your hand, but how many of you have some kind of question in your mind that you're waiting for God to answer one day? Have some kind of question in your mind that you're hoping to get an answer from God. And now Job has his chance. Finally, you know, God shows up. You know, all the while Job is saying, I just wish the Almighty would come down and he could settle all this and set things straight. But, you know, God is silent through that whole conversation that Job has with his friends. But before we get to God's answer, and I'm not going to take the time to even read any of these, but there's this whole passage of several chapters near the end of Job where this young man by the name of Elihu, who we don't know who he is, and he hasn't been mentioned before, but he's obviously been sitting in on this long dialogue and conversation between Job and his three friends. And after Job finishes his speech and he says, this is all she wrote. I'm done. Not going to say anymore. Before God steps in and responds to Job and to his friends, Elihu decides to take it upon himself to respond to them. And in all honesty, he pretty much lectures them. He says to Job's friends, hey, you guys, through this whole conversation, you have not been able to prove that Job is wrong and that Job sinned. And then he says that he makes an emphatic point of saying, but in all of this, God is not wrong. And so the best quote, and I'll summarize the whole, I think there's four chapters where Elihu is responding. You can sum it up in this. He says, far be it from God to do evil. Far be it from the Almighty to do wrong. So to sum up Elihu's long speech, he's saying to Job's friends, you can't really prove that Job is wrong or that he has sinned. But one thing I can say, Elihu is getting across, is that God is not wrong. So it's interesting that you get to the end of that long speech, which goes from chapter 32 to the end of chapter 37, and Job doesn't answer Elihu, neither do his three friends, but God shows up in a whirlwind or in a storm and begins to speak to Job. And it's interesting to me to note that God doesn't have anything to say to Elihu, and he doesn't have anything to say to Job's three friends. He just speaks directly to Job. Well, let me help you set the stage for this, and I want you to think about this before we hear God's response of Job. You don't have, again, don't raise your hand or anything. I will raise mine, but do you have some questions you'd like to ask God someday? I'll raise my hand. Probably. Job did, you know, in his defense of his integrity that we read last week in Job 31. He said, oh, I wish I had somebody who could hear me. And he says, I sign now my defense. I don't think he was literally signing up, but he's saying, I'm signing off. I'm ending my defense. Let the Almighty answer me. Job longed to have God answer his questions. And if we're honest, especially when we look at things that are either happen in our lives or our family or things that are happening in the world, I mean, we're by nature, we want answers. We want to understand. We have questions for God. And I wonder, have you ever said this? When I get to heaven, I want to ask God, dot, 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 dot. You fill in the blank. When I get to heaven, I want to ask God. Or maybe you say, I've got some questions for God. And I've been in those conversations, and people have said, you know, but as soon as I get to heaven, I've got some questions that I want to ask God. And I thought about that, and really that whole kind of attitude that we have goes all the way back to the Garden of Eden. The temptation that Adam and Eve gave into in eating the fruit of the tree of the knowledge of good and evil, that temptation was to know what God knows, to know good and evil. Adam and Eve wanted to understand things, and from the very beginning of time, we as human beings, we want to know like God knows. We want to understand. We want to have an explanation. And so the big question of humanity down through all the centuries, all the millennia, the big question of humanity, especially in times of hardship and suffering, is why? We want to know why. There's probably a lot of people right now who are asking the question about the coronavirus, about what our country's going through, about what our world is going through. They're wanting to know the answer to the question, why? And I've often thought about that thing of the conversations I've had about, well, when we get to heaven, what's the first thing we want to ask God? And here's what I think. This is my opinion. When you get to heaven, when I get to heaven, we will forget all of our questions. It will not matter one iota why. It will not matter to us why. I don't think we're going to be in a line, standing in line to wait our turn to get to God, to tell him what's on our mind and to ask why. I think we will be so overwhelmed with the beauty and the glory and the wonder of heaven, we're not even going to think about asking why. And nothing that has happened in this life, no matter how horrible it is, will have any comparison to the weight of the glory that we experience in God's presence. But in the meantime, aren't we a bit arrogant sometimes when we insist that God tell us why? Especially, we want answers to the questions we have about the trials of life. And what had happened through this whole process for Job as he was wrestling with these why questions is that he had started to, you know, he starts off really humble, but as he goes through this process, he begins to elevate himself and he begins to demand that God gives him answers. You know, I want the Almighty to come down here and give me an answer and to set all this thing right. And you see this transition where God is up here and Job is down here. And Job, by his questions and his thinking, is bringing God down a little and raising himself up a little. And like us, I think Job had come to a place where he was obsessed with it's all about me and my suffering and what I'm going through. And I have these questions and I want things to be made right. And it's almost as if God was expecting, or Job was expecting God to do something for him, to come down, to answer his questions, to serve him. And I think we get into trouble that way when we start to have a view of God where we think God is there to serve us, to solve our problems, to answer all of our questions. And we need to be really careful because we can become like Job, who was getting to a place where he felt that somehow God owed him. And we dare not be in a place in our lives where we feel like God owes us. Oh, we've done all these good things. Think of all the prayers I've prayed. Think of all the money I've given. Think of all the Bible studies I've attended. God owes me something. And so Job wanted God to give him an answer. He almost demanded that God give him an answer. And we come to Job chapter 38, and we find that God does give Job an answer. Boy, oh boy, does he give Job an answer. And it is not at all what Job expected. And you, if you've never read this passage, you may be thinking, wow, God's putting Job in his place. You see, here's the thing. God answers, but he doesn't answer any of Job's questions. He doesn't answer one question. He doesn't explain anything to Job about his suffering. In fact, he turns the tables on Job, and he asks Job a series of questions. About 70 questions, depending on how you take the phrasing in there. It's just one question after another. And all of these essentially are questions that Job cannot really answer. God confronts Job. These chapters are, one teacher I was listening to this week said God was confrontational with Job. And you'll see as we read a couple of these passages, God's almost sarcastic with Job. Yeah, you know, don't you, Job? You know all the answers to these mysteries of the universe. And God speaks in a way that humbles Job, makes him see his place, and come back to a place where he worships God. So if you have your Bibles or your Bible app on your phone, you can turn with me to the book of Job, to Job chapter 38. And I'm just going to take a few minutes to read through some of these portions. And again, realize that this is written in a poetic form, but this is Job expressing himself to God coming up to this point, and now it's God's opportunity to respond. And we'll see basically three different approaches that God takes with Job. And so I'm just going to read. You can follow along beginning in verse 1 of Job chapter 38. Then the Lord answered Job out of the storm. So imagine this whirlwind, this windstorm that's coming, and out of that God answers. And it's apparently audible, because later you'll see that his three friends, God also spoke to them. So this is one of those moments where there is an audible voice coming out of a storm, and this is what God says to Job. Who is this that darkens my counsel with words without knowledge? Brace yourself like a man. I will question you, and you shall answer me. Where were you when I laid the earth's foundations? Tell me, if you understand. Who marked off its dimensions? Surely you know. Who stretched a measuring line across it? Oh, on what were its footings set? Or who laid its cornerstone? While the morning stars sang together and all the angels shouted for joy. Who shut up the sea behind the doors when it burst forth from the womb, when I made the clouds its garments and cloaked it in thick darkness, when I fixed limits for it and set its doors and bars in place, when I said, this far you may come and no further. Here is where your proud waves halt. Have you ever given orders to the morning or shown the dawn its place? That it might take the earth by the edges and shake the wicked out of it. I'm going to keep reading down through here a little more. The earth takes shape like clay under a seal. Its features stand out like those of a garment. The wicked are denied their light, and their upraised arm is broken. Have you journeyed to the springs of the sea or walked in the recesses of the deep? Have the gates of death been shown to you? Have you seen the gates of the shadow of death? Have you comprehended the vast expanses of the earth? Tell me if you know all this. What is the way to the abode of light? And where does darkness reside? Can you take them to their places? Did you know the paths of their dwelling? Surely you know, for you were already born. You have lived so many years. And the question that God is asking Job is, hey, Job, were you around at creation? Now, Job has a sense enough not to answer any of these questions, and God doesn't really let him answer because he keeps going. But I'm thinking what must have been going on in Job's mind or would have been going on in my mind. Well, I wasn't born when the foundations of the earth were laid. I don't know how these things came about. I'm just a man. I can't do all these things. God makes a point of showing Job how small he is, how little power he has, and he points out the fact that he is the creator and Job is not. And then if you turn over or go down a few more verses to verse 31, you will find that God is taking this further, and he's talking about the constellation and the stars that are in the universe. And in verse 31, he says, "Can you bind the beautiful Pleiades? Can you loose the cords of Orion? Can you bring forth the constellations in their seasons or lead out the bear with its cubs? Do you know the laws of the heavens? Can you set up God's dominion over the earth? Can you raise your voice to the clouds and cover yourself with a flood of water? Do you send the lightning bolts on their way? Do they report to you, 'We are here'? Who endowed the heart with wisdom or gave understanding to the mind? Who has the wisdom to count the clouds or can tip over the water jars of the heavens when the dust becomes hard and the clods of earth stick together?" And so God is getting at Job and saying, "Okay, Job, were you around at the beginning of creation?" And Job's, if he even could get a word in and answer, he'd say, "Well, no, I wasn't there. I don't know how these things came about. Do you know how the universe works, Job? Do you know these things?" And Job would have to answer, "Well, actually, not. I didn't do very good in science in school, and I don't know how the universe works." And then you get over into chapter 39, and go down to verse 19 of chapter 39, and God is basically saying, "Can you provide for all the creatures in nature? Can you control all the creatures in nature?" And in chapter 39, verse 19, this is what we read. He talks about several other things, but I just picked this out. "Do you give the horse his strength or clothe his neck with a flowing mane? Do you make him leap like a locust, striking terror with his proud snorting? He paws fiercely, rejoicing in his strength, and he charges into the fray. He laughs at fear, afraid of nothing. He does not shy away from the sword. The quiver rattles against his side along with the flashing spear and lance. In frenzied excitement, he eats up the ground. He cannot stand still when the trumpet sounds. At the blast of the trumpet, he snorts, 'Aha!' He catches the scent of battle and the shout of commanders and the battle cry. Does the hawk take flight by your wisdom and spread its wings toward the south? Does the eagle soar on your command and build his nest on high? He dwells on a cliff and stays there at night. A rocky crag is his stronghold. From there he seeks out his food. His eyes detect it from the air. His young ones feast on blood. And where the slain are, there he is." And so if you were to look at that whole chapter, God is basically saying, "Okay, Job, look at all of creation. Do you understand how all of this works? Can you provide for all the creatures in nature? Can you control all the creatures in nature?" And what's God doing? He's basically trying to show Job, "Okay, Job, I am God, you are not. You were not there in the beginning. You didn't create any of this. You don't even fully understand how a lot of this works." And you get to chapter 40, and you see that God challenges Job. And he says, "Who will contend with the Almighty? Correct him. Who will the one who contends with the Almighty correct him? Let him who accuses God answer him." So God stops for a minute and he says, "Okay, Job, here's your chance. How are you going to answer these questions?" And Job doesn't try to argue any of it. He doesn't try to pull out his biology book or his science book or his book on astronomy. He doesn't try to do anything to say, "Well, God, I think this is how the universe works." Job just doesn't say anything. And instead, this is what he says. "I am unworthy. How can I reply to you? I put my hand over my mouth. I spoke once, but I have no answer. Twice, but I will say no more." So Job just says, I can't say anything. I'm just going to shut up. I'm not going to say anything, because he realizes that he's completely humbled in the presence of God. And he realizes that God is vast and immense and eternal. And Job is just, in a sense, a temporary speck on the whole scope of time. Job didn't argue with God about any of that, did he? And you would think that, well, that would end the story. But God wasn't done yet. And in chapter 40, in just a portion of that, we see that God addresses Job now on a more personal thing. It's not just about where were you when the universe was formed, what do you know about creation, what are the limits of your power, but now God spoke to Job again out of the storm in chapter 40, verse 6. Then the Lord spoke to Job. He said, "Brace yourself like a man. I will question you, and you shall answer me. Would you discredit my justice? Would you condemn me to justify yourself? Do you have an arm like God's, and can your voice thunder like him, his? Then adorn yourself with glory and splendor, and clothe yourself in honor and majesty. Unleash the fury of your wrath. Look at every proud man and bring him low. Look at every proud man and humble him. Crush the wicked where they stand. Bury them all in the dust together. Shroud their faces in the grave. Then I myself will admit to you that your own right hand can save you." And so God just gets right down to the heart of things with Job. And he addresses Job's accusation that God was not fair and just. And he addresses Job's attempts to try to justify himself. And essentially what God was saying in this passage is, okay, Job, if you know better than me, then why don't you clothe yourself with honor and majesty? Why don't you be the one who judges the earth? And I think if you could sum all that up, what God is saying to Job is this: why don't you be God? Job, why don't you be God? And I think therein is the exact problem that the book of Job is getting at. We, as fallen human beings, we want to be God, at least in the little g sense. We want to be in control. We want to be a savior for everyone else. We want to have all the answers. We want to solve all of the problems. And in times like that, God has a knack for showing us just how small we are. Now, I'm not going to read these verses, but if you look beginning in the middle of chapter 15, or chapter 40, verse 15, and go all the way through the end of chapter 41, God is describing these two creatures, the behemoth, who by definition is a huge, monstrous creature. It means gigantic and powerful. Some speculate, some say, well, it was a hippopotamus. Others say that it was maybe something like a woolly mammal. Others say that it was one of the dinosaurs. We're not really given, there's not clarity in that. The point was, first God takes time to describe this largest land animal of the time that Job would have been aware of, this huge monstrous creature. And then he talks about the Leviathan, which some say was a giant crocodile. I don't know, they have these like sci-fi movies on. Have you ever seen one of those, the crocodile, giant crocs or something like that? And this huge, you know, alligator or crocodile comes out of the lake and eats people and stuff like that. I don't know if that's what he had in mind. Some say that it was a picture of a sea serpent or a sea monster by definition. And we can lose ourselves in trying to figure out all of those things. In the Leviathan, God ends by saying, "Nothing on earth is his equal, a creature without fear. He looks down on all that are haughty. He is king over all that are proud." The point, I think the main point that God is trying to make here is the behemoth and the Leviathan. He gives these two examples. They are huge. And Job, you are small. And there's a verse in that description of the Leviathan where God, in the middle of all that, asked Job, "Can you make a pet out of him and put him on a leash?" Job, you know, there are creatures in this created world that are so much bigger than you that you are nothing in comparison. In other words, what God is trying to get across in all of these is, I'm God, you're not. Job, you are, think about how small you are. God didn't exactly say this, but it's kind of like Job. You are really, really small compared to this creation, compared to this universe, compared to other things that you see around you. And what God is doing in all of this for Job and what he does for us is he puts things back in perspective. And he's showing Job that he doesn't know everything. And it's almost like he's saying to Job, Job, you couldn't run the universe for one day. And yet you're asking me all these questions like I should have to answer to you. In our own limited, finite knowledge and wisdom, we cannot ever truly understand how God works. I don't understand all of this that's going on around us with the COVID-19, with the virus. I don't understand past pandemics. I know that we live in a fallen and a broken world that is affected by evil, but if I try to understand all that and wrap my mind around it, I'm at a loss. And God brings Job kind of to that place. Job, I'm God, you're not. Job, this whole universe is huge, and you're just a small part of that. And so in the end, let me close with these words that Job says at the conclusion of what God has to say. It's in the beginning of Job chapter 42. Then Job replied to the Lord, I know that you can do all things. No plan of yours can be thwarted. You asked, who is this that darkens my counsel without knowledge? And now listen to this. Surely I spoke of things I did not understand, things too wonderful for me to know. Job realizes that he doesn't understand all of God's ways. He doesn't understand what's happening in the universe. He doesn't understand why he's suffering. And he comes to that place where instead of demanding an answer, he accepts the fact that he doesn't know. And he continues, he said, you said, listen now and I will speak. I will question you and you shall answer me. My eyes, my ears had heard of you, but now my eyes have seen you. Therefore, I despise myself and repent in dust and ashes. And it's like Job is finally coming to this place where he says, okay, now I see, now I get it. I didn't know what I was talking about. I spoke of things I did not understand, things that were too wonderful for me. This is a picture of Job finally coming to the place where he's humbled before God. And he repented, and what he was repenting of was the fact that he had blamed God for wrongdoing. And the bottom line of this story that's almost coming to an end is that Job came back to a place where he was willing to let God be God and trust him. To me, that's the beauty of this chapter, the beauty of Job's response. He came back to a place where he was willing to let God be God and trust him. And I want to suggest to you that I need to do that, and we need to do that. We all have times of struggles and problems and suffering and pain and grief. And our tendency is to want answers. We want some kind of explanation. We want God to tell us why this is happening. And God wants to bring us back to a place of complete trust, even if we don't know why. Stand with me as we close in prayer. Lord, remind us, whether it's through something that we see or something that we hear or something that we read, remind us through your Spirit that you are God, that we are not, that we don't have all the answers, and that we can trust you even when we don't see, even when we don't understand, even though when we don't know why things are the way that they are. Just reveal yourself to us, that we can come to a place of just simple trust, that we can be humble before you. Help us not to be demanding of answers and solutions, but help us to rest in your grace, rest in your love, rest in knowing that if we have put our trust in Jesus, we belong to you, that we're part of your family. Help us to look at our lives and our world in a different way. Be the compassion and the love that you want us to be in these times, and not to worry about the questions of why and what the answers are, but to trust you and to walk in your ways. We pray these things in Jesus' name. Amen. God bless you all. Have a wonderful week.